There's a lot of conflict about climate change. Does eating beef hurt the environment? How can global warming be real if we have thick ice and snowstorms? If that sounds wild to you, that's okay. Those are just parts of the full epic drama that is climate change. It sounds crazy until you get the full picture, so let's get started. Our climate always changes. Earth is here, the sun is here, when we move closer to the sun, we get hotter. But Earth is getting much hotter, so whose fault is that? Yeah, we are the biggest cause of global warming. Don't tell me it's because you're hot. Benedict Cumberbatch is the only person who's allowed to say that. Enter Act 1 of this story. The sun keeps us warm by shortwave ultraviolet rays to Earth. The Earth radiates it back out as heat, or scientifically speaking, long-wave infrared rays. Some of it goes back to space, and the rest are trapped around our Earth thanks to greenhouse gases. Greenhouse gases are like a blanket around the Earth. The more greenhouse gases in the atmosphere, the thicker the blanket, and the more heat is trapped on Earth. It's like how heat can't escape from the glass in a greenhouse. So yeah, that's the greenhouse effect. So what are greenhouse gases? Some common ones are carbon dioxide, methane, nitrous oxide, water vapor, and chlorofluorocarbons. We emit a lot of greenhouse gases, especially carbon dioxide. What else comes to mind when I say greenhouse? Right, trees. Trees do something really special called photosynthesis, where they take carbon dioxide from the air and convert it to chemical energy. And they release oxygen back into the atmosphere. But what do we do with this biological marvel? We burn them! You see, we need a lot of space for agriculture, so raising livestock and growing crops. According to the World Wildlife Fund, agriculture is the biggest single cause of deforestation. What? As a result, we have much fewer trees to clear the air of carbon dioxide. At the same time, cows emit about 2 billion metric tons of greenhouse gases every year. Obviously, there's methane and while the bacteria that feed on poop release carbon dioxide. It's a simplified description. Essentially, a lot of greenhouse gases come from cows because they fart and poop a lot. You can change that by eating less beef or none at all. We also use a type of land called peatlands for agriculture. Peatlands are waterlogged and made up of decayed organic matter, so they contain a lot of carbon. When we drain peatlands to grow crops, the organic matter in the peatland is exposed to oxygen. This speeds up decomposition, which we now know releases CO2. Worse still, when the peatlands dry up, there's a greater risk of peatland fire, which releases more CO2 and N2O. Now that we know how much greenhouse gases are flowing around our Earth, what are the consequences? TLDR, here is a list. Okay, number one, polar ice caps melt. It's important to know the difference between sea ice and land ice. Sea ice is frozen seawater, so imagine freezing a cup of water and letting it melt. The water level remains the same. Now, land ice is ice that comes from land, like glaciers and ice sheets. Sometimes the ice flows down, forming an ice sheet that's still connected to land. When parts of the ice sheet break, they form icebergs. Let's go back to our cup of water. Land ice in the sea is like adding ice cubes to water. When land ice melts, the water level in the cup rises. More on the melting process. There's something called ice albedo feedback, which is not the ice judging you for your bad environmental decisions, even though it should. Ice albedo is the proportion of light that's reflected off the surface of the ice. Yeah, that sounds like jargon, so let's go to the examples. So, another name we give the light that beams down from the sun is radiation. In the case of thick ice, the white surface reflects 90% of radiation, because you know it's white reflective. Physics, and absorbs 10%. So the albedo is 0.9. Let's say the ice melts completely. Now, the dark ocean water absorbs 90% of light and reflects only 10%. So the albedo is 0.1. This is called a positive feedback mechanism because when more ice melts, more of the dark ocean water is exposed. That means a lot of heat will be absorbed, warming the ocean and causing even more melting. So it's a cycle that makes your initial effect more and more severe. The opposite of this is cloud feedback, which is a negative feedback mechanism. When the ocean gets warmer, there's more evaporation, which forms clouds that prevent radiation from passing through to Earth, and that makes the ocean cooler, as in less warm. So negative feedback is a cycle that leads to the opposite effect. Great, or should I say nice? Now back to the ice. We know that land ice melting causes sea levels to rise. What's more, when the ocean gets warmer, it expands. What happens is shorelines get eroded because the waves crash further inland. For people who live along the coast, that could mean more destruction and even displacement from their homes due to floods. Coastal systems like mangrove forests are also destroyed when the mangroves get uprooted by the waves. Next, when temperatures rise, permafrost starts to thaw. As the name suggests, permafrost is a permanently frozen layer of soil. It lies underneath the active layer, which is a layer of ice that melts during the summer. When the permafrost thaws, all of this organic matter is exposed to the air, so they start to decompose, releasing CO2 and methane. Here are two more interesting facts about permafrost. You might have heard of so-called zombie pathogens.
It's important to be prepared for the worst. Bloodborne pathogens.
In 2016, a heatwave thawed the permafrost in the Arctic, revealing reindeer carcasses that died from anthrax bacteria. The bacteria also thawed, spread across the Arctic, and infected dozens of people. You can probably consider it a consolation that anthrax is basically known for hibernating in soil and then springing back up. Other viruses we've found in permafrost so far, like smallpox and pneumonia, haven't been able to survive, mainly because they're used to occupying warm, cozy bodies and not freezing temperatures. Another effect of melting permafrost that made the news is the flooding of the global seed vault in 2016. This vault is buried in a mountain deep within the Arctic Circle and contains nearly a million packets of seeds. It's meant to provide a fail-safe protection against any disaster that wipes out our food supplies. Because of the heat wave, water flooded the tunnels leading to the vault. Thankfully, it froze up again before it reached the vault. But think about it, the global seed vault is supposed to last us through generations. That's some food for thought. Next, we have extreme weather. Not just heat waves, but also storms and hurricanes. You know the drill. Higher temperature means more evaporation, which means more water vapor in the air, so more rain. Theoretically, as a cycle, this is
perfectly balanced,
as Thanos would say. But nature is not Thanos. What happens is, rain clouds get blown to other parts of the world. So while water is evaporating from one place, another place keeps raining. This leads to two extremes: drought and heavy storms. The same thing applies to heavy snow. If the ocean gets warmer, that means more evaporation, and when water vapor comes into contact with cool air, you get more snow. When you get heavy rain, there's also a higher risk of flooding, especially in urban areas because it's really hard for the water to drain. That could lead to pollution and waterborne diseases. Global warming also stresses our freshwater supplies. Glaciers are our natural reservoirs that store water as ice in winter and melts again in summer. With global warming, the ice melts earlier, so less water is left when summer actually arrives, when we need it most. Now going back to flooding, the dirty water might get flushed into our reservoirs, contaminating our waters again. And with rising temperatures, bacteria can multiply in our reservoirs much more easily. That's kind of gross. Here's something a bit more colorful. Corals! First of all, corals are animals. They have a hard protective limestone skeleton called a calicle, and inside it is a soft squishy polyp. First, a polyp attaches to a rock on the seafloor and butts into thousands of close connected by their calicles. A reef is formed when colonies join with other colonies. Corals are colorful thanks to a microalgae called zooxanthellae. Zooxanthellae undergo photosynthesis and provide organic carbon for corals that need them. In return, the corals provide zooxanthellae with shelter and UV protection. So warmer water causes zooxanthellae to leave the coral, which results in coral bleaching. The corals then starve and become vulnerable to disease. When you think about how much carbon dioxide there is in the air, naturally there's more of that will dissolve in the ocean. Carbon dioxide, being an acidic gas, leads to the acidification of seawater, which prevents corals from absorbing calcium carbonate, which they need to maintain or grow their limestone skeletons. Of course, that's bad news for sea animals that depend on corals for survival, whether as a habitat or part of the food web. As for poikilotherms like fish and insects, warmer temperatures could trigger tropical fishes to swim towards the Earth's poles, because that's where the water is colder and therefore containing more dissolved oxygen. For a similar reasons, insects migrate to new habitat, like the green stink bug, which destroys crops for a living. It's hard to blame them because insects have a narrow thermal safety margin, which means anything too hot or too cold will kill them, kind of like a grotesque Goldilocks. That kind of applies to us too. Heat waves cause a lot of heat-related death because we can't survive beyond a narrow range of temperatures. Congratulations for making it this far, because now we are going on a trip, also known as a guilt trip. Allow me to bring your attention to this cute critter called the American Pika. Global warming has forced it to higher and higher altitudes, and soon it will have nowhere to go. Migration is serious because it brings animals to new habitats where they may face native predators or competition that they aren't adapted for. Even the timing of migration matters. Take for instance the great tit. Don't laugh. Because of global warming, they've kind of been knocked out of sync. The mom migrates to her nesting ground too early, so her chicks hatch way before there are enough insects for them to eat. It's not a climate change video if we don't talk about polar bears. In the Arctic, melting sea ice means less sea algae in the ice for zooplankton to eat. That leads to less zooplankton for Arctic cod, which means less food for the seals. What eat seals? Polar bears. As you know, polar bears are bearing the brunt of our actions. Melting sea ice means fewer and smaller platforms for polar bears to rest or travel on. They would also have to crowd together in the same space, which makes diseases spread a lot more easily. Young polar bears might also get trampled in such a small space. It's affecting their population as well. Polar bears are spending more time on land and hybridizing with grizzly bears. So there's a chance grizzly and ice bear or wee bear bears are actually brothers. But to be scientifically accurate, when grizzly bears mate with polar bears, their kids are actually hybrids called roller bears. Panda is still definitely adopted though. In other Arctic news, the Arctic hare can change coat colors depending on the season. It's white in winter and brown in summer. When the snow thaws in winter due to higher temperatures, the hare will still be white while everything around it is brown. If a wolf sees this, the hare doesn't stand a chance. All that said and done, let's move to something a little bit more vegetative. Plants. They are pretty shady because there's so much going on with them, but we can't see it. For example, they deal with climate change by 1. Closing the stomata to reduce transpiration and therefore reducing water loss. 2. Increasing their root-to-shoot ratio to absorb more water. And 3. Reducing the number and size of their leaves. Unfortunately, points 1 and 3 also affect plants' photosynthesis, which hinders their growth. Another side effect of climate change on plants is that their reproduction is disrupted. Because of synchronization issues, wrong species, I meant the early spider orchid. This orchid looks like a female minor bee. It even produces the same sex pheromones to seduce male bees into something called pseudocopulation, which helps to pollinate the orchid. Normally, female minor bees emerge much later than the male bees, but warmer temperatures are making the female bees emerge 15 days earlier, meaning that the males are more likely to mate with them instead of mating with the orchids. Which is really sad for the orchids because first of all, they deserve their fun time, and second of all, they need to survive. As populations, plants are also starting to shift, albeit more slowly. Plants, like most living organisms, have an ideal range of environmental conditions. So when temperatures rise, the population starts to shift to higher altitudes or higher latitudes towards the poles. Tropical forests, however, may not do so well. Climate change is happening so fast, many species might not be able to migrate in time. That could lead to, drumroll, extinction. At this point, there is a slight possibility that plants and polar bears are not really your thing, in which case you've come to the right section. How does climate change affect us specifically? Earlier, we've talked about deforestation and plants possibly going extinct. Now, tropical rainforests, like the Amazon, are incredible resources for pharmaceutical products. And by driving them extinct, we lose important health discoveries. For example, we take curare from the curare liana. We need curare from the curare lianas plant in the Amazon to make muscle relaxants for Parkinson's disease and multiple sclerosis. Similarly, coral reefs are known as medicine cabinets of the 21st century. Being stationary, they have evolved amazing chemical defenses to protect themselves from predators. Even if you have no feelings for coral, you can't deny their incredible potential that we are missing out if we just let them bleach and die for nothing. Now, food. Okay, I can't do this, it's cold. We return to the rainforest because surprise surprise, that is where 80% of our food comes from. There is way more genetic variability in forest plants compared to the crops we grow, which all come from the same strain. In the event that our crop strain gets wiped out, we need the different genetic traits from the forest species to make stronger crops. On that note, climate change is a serious threat to our food. Higher temperatures allow pests and weeds to thrive and kill our crops. More rainfall could lead to flooding that kills our crops. When sea levels rise, salt water could intrude into groundwater, and guess what? Kill our crops! When it comes to animals, our livestock may experience heat stress thanks to global warming, and salmon. When there's less and less ice, there's also less and less water, which means the streams that the salmon swim in will be more shallow, which makes it easier for bears to eat them. Less for you if you love salmon. Warmer stream temperatures also make it easier for them to fall sick. What does that mean? Less salmon for you. You know what? I'm just gonna put a picture here. Have it rough, the fish have it rougher. TLDR, global warming is the enemy of anyone who even vaguely likes food. Now, there's a whole other section on climate change causing diseases, but it also has stuff about viruses and the immune system, which are pretty much full-fledged stories on their own. And this video has gone on for long enough. I promise the next video will be a lot easier to handle. There will be a giveaway. Naturally, following this, the next video is going to be about environmental friendliness, which I've been paying more attention to since it's plastic-free July and all. So stay tuned to that by subscribing, wink wink, and leave a comment if there's anything you'd like to see next. Thanks!